Facing Dead Ahead by Kylie Pearman. I don't know what it is, but there's no one on the highway tonight. There are no trucks or cars or semis, no taillights or headlights to be seen. All that rests in front of me is the gray asphalt made inky black by the night, striped with the sunflower yellow road markings. I tap my finger against my phone screen. It comes to life in a square of bright white, rendering me near blind, like the flash of a photo. ETA, 19 minutes. It almost seems like too long. Feeling a little uneasy. The radio is intoning something slow and quiet, and it quickens the restless thing in my stomach. I turn the volume up. The song is one I've never heard before. String instruments play a lulling, almost classical symphony, despite the station being a constant advertiser of the most popular songs. I turn the dial to see if maybe I'm on the wrong station, but there's nothing but static on the next frequency, and the next, and the next, and the next, all static, save for the classical music. I turn the tuning dial for something other than prickling static or symphony, but there's nothing else, no other song or voice to be heard. I jam my finger against the knob, cutting the music off fast, plunging the car into tangible silence. It's almost better than the music. I tap my phone again. ETA, 17 minutes. I pass the green signs indicating which exit is where, what town is in which direction, the shield-shaped electric blue signs with highway numbers that I still haven't even tried to memorize, the trees, tall and dark, all blending together outside my windows. I know I'm close to home. I just wish I was closer. I check again. ETA, 15 minutes. My car radio kicks in with a sizzling pop, and the speakers scream the shrill, blaring alarm for the emergency alert system. I slam my palm against the radio dial on instinct, desperate to silence the noise. I've always hated it. Makes my skin erupt with a feeling of panic, itchy like I imagine 100,000 bugs would be if they were streamlined into my veins all at once. The alert persists through my attempts to shut it up. My phone is buzzing too, harmonizing with the car's radio urgency. A prickling fear starts at my toes and shoots up, 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 a painful shock all the way up to my scalp, setting my nerves on razor-sharp edge. A tiny robotic voice comes through. This is a national emergency. Important instructions will follow. The radio lets out a long, low-toned beep, and then the voice continues. The following message is transmitted at the request of the United States government. This is not a test. Foreign entities have been detected in your area. Take shelter immediately. Do not leave your home for any reason. Do not let anyone or anything into your home, even if it claims to be a member of your family. If something moves outside your home, do not investigate. If something moves inside your home, do not investigate. If you see something outside your home, do not interact. If you see something inside your home, do not interact. Turn off every light inside your home. Do not make any loud noises. Do not look out any windows. This message will repeat itself in 30. The speakers let out a long, shrill screech, and the message dissolves into static. Fear spikes hard in my chest, in my heart, bright and all-encompassing. This isn't real. I can't breathe past the terror clawing its way up my throat. I reach for my phone with a trembling hand too fast. I drop it on the floorboard and it slides right down to the gas pedal. I'm desperate now. My breath comes in gasps, my cheek pressed hard against the steering wheel as I grapple blindly for the phone by my feet. I'm swerving. I can feel it, but I don't care. I need my phone. I need to call someone, anyone. My fingers brush the plastic case, and then I have it. Thank God. I shoot up into my seat, set my eyes back on the road to right myself. There's something standing in the road. It's not far off. It's looking right at me. I slam on the brakes out of pure instinct. My tires squeal and my car rockets me forward. My head jerks down hard. My chin clips the top of the wheel and my vision goes starry with the pain. I fit a hole clean through my tongue. I can taste the coppery tang of blood. I heave wild eyes up to the road. Nothing. Utterly, completely empty. I crush my foot onto the gas. My tires skid against the road in the way my dad always told me to avoid. But I don't care. I need to get home. My breaths are ragged. Now my lungs feel tight and constricted, like they're full of rocks and fear and liquid cement. My map turned itself off like it decided to run and hide and leave me all alone, like it was scared too. I hold my phone up to my face and swipe a sweaty thumb across the screen to unlock it. One hand still on the wheel. My whole body is shaking. I can't feel my legs. I click on the green phone icon and scroll through the recent calls until I find Dad. I click the call button so hard that I break the tip of my thumbnail right off. It bleeds. I can't feel it. It rings. Rings. Call failed. I try again. Call failed. Again. Call failed. Call failed. Please. It doesn't even ring anymore. I send texts with unsteady fingers. Hello. Please call. Is this really happening? Dad. I'm scared. All of the texts pop up with a red exclamation mark indicating that they didn't go through. They can't go through. I can see my exit now, just a little ways down. The exit that leads straight into town. I've never been so happy to see that sign and that off-ramp. I speed up fast as my car will go. If I can just get to that exit, I'll be okay. I'm so close to home. And in a shower of sparks and glass, my headlights burst. I scream. I swerve my wheel like I can get away from it, like it's something I can avoid. And the engine dies. Tears are in free fall down my cheeks, burning trails from my eyes. I can't take any air into my lungs. I can't breathe past the paralyzing terror. And my car skids and spins to a stop. I grab my keys and twist them in the ignition. But the engine turns over. Again. And again. And again. The engine rumbles and sputters and dies. The wheel won't move. Won't turn even in the merest inch. I stomp on the accelerator like that will do something. Like it'll take me home. It doesn't. Of course it doesn't. I try my phone again. I try everything. Call failed. 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 The engine lets out a weak, pathetic groan, and it doesn't make any more noise after that, no matter what I try. I'm so close to home. So close now. I can make it. I unlock the doors, grab for the handle, and pull. There's the quiet snick of locks shifting. I didn't even touch them. They locked themselves. The doors locked themselves. I yank on the handle. I physically hold the lock on open, and I yank on the handle, and the door doesn't budge. The window. I start banging on the glass with my fists, a raw and visceral scream dislodging from my throat. I shift my whole body sideways and start kicking the glass like I'm sinking down, down, down into a lake. Like I'll drown if I don't get out of this car. Like an animal in a cage. There's not a single scratch on the glass when I stop, exhausted, worn down with dread. I let my head fall back against the seat. I let my eyelids flutter shut, just for a moment. I can still taste blood. I can get home. I know I can. Because I'm so close, and everything will be fine. And if I just get home, I'll be okay. If I just get home, this will all be over. I open my eyes, and I put my hands on the wheel. I glance up at the rearview mirror out of pure instinct, and I see something in my back seat. I don't move. I don't breathe. I look away fast, cast my gaze out the windshield, like looking away will save me. It won't. It can't. The backseat creaks, slowly, surely. In the corner of my eye, I see it. It leans forward, 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 and I see it. With my eyes facing dead ahead, it cranes its head toward me, right in the space between the seats. I perceive its contorted neck. I hear it crack and snap like a handful of broken bones. It's looking at me. It's looking right at me. I can feel its breath on my cheek. I silently turn my head and I look. The end.